Hello, hi, my dear friends. Welcome to my channel HSR BioInfo. Today we are going to discuss one more important organelle of cell, that is mitochondria. Okay, actually mitochondria, which is simply called as powerhouse of cell, because of it generates the ATP of energy. Okay, that's why it is called as powerhouse of cell, and it is initially identified by a scientist called as Kolliker in the year of 1857. After that, these structures were not named by the Kolliker. After Kolliker, a scientist called Altman in the year of 1886 named these structures as bioplasts. Finally, the mitochondria name was coined by a scientist called as Benda in the year of 1898. This is all about the background, how the invention and name was given to the mitochondrial structures of cell. Okay, after that, the mitochondria is a powerhouse of cell. Very, very important peculiar point. These mitochondria number is vary from one cell to the another cell. The minimum number of mitochondria is 1 per cell, which was identified in the Chlamydomonas and Chlorella. The maximum number of mitochondria in cell are the 5 lakhs, which was identified in the flying muscle of insect. Which is showing the clear idea that wherever the energy is must need, such type of cells produces, and such type of cells contains the high number like 5 lakhs in the flying muscle of insects. The insect that contains the flying muscle, which is essential for the flying of that insect, such flying needs more energy. So that's why that muscle cells contains the 5 lakhs of mitochondria. I already mentioned the mitochondria is the powerhouse of cell. That means it produces the energy. It is a site of production of energy. That's why it is called as a powerhouse of cell. In that condition, which contains the 5 lakhs mitochondria in the flying muscle cell. Here, Chlamydomonas and Chlorella are the unicellular organisms that contains and that needs only one mitochondria per cell for their movement and their function. So, in this way, the number is varied from one cell to the another cell. Coming to the shape of mitochondria is vary in one species to the another species, but overally the shape of mitochondria is a spherical or oval. Spherical or oval. Let us start with the structure of mitochondria. Structure of mitochondria. Let us draw a simple diagram which showing the all the components which are present in the mitochondria of cell. This is the mitochondrial structure, oval in shape. The mitochondria that contains the outer membrane. And also the mitochondria that contains the inner membrane also. That's why it is a double layer membrane structures, double membrane structure organelle. So, but here the inner structure get folded into many folds inside like this. So, here also the foldings can show like this. In this way. Here the inner membrane of mitochondria get folded inside into form a inner membrane. Inner membrane, the foldings which are present here are called as a cristae. These are the components, outer membrane and inner membrane and cristae. The space between these inner membrane and also outer membrane, inner membrane and also outer membrane, that is called as a perimitochondrial space. Or intermitochondrial space. Now, the inner membrane, outer membrane, perimitochondrial space. Now, the inner side of the inner membrane, inner side of the inner membrane, a space is filled with the some components. Such space we called as a matrix. This is the space, this all this is space. This space is filled with the many components and that space we called as a matrix of mitochondria. Matrix of mitochondria. Now, this matrix is very essential for many functions of mitochondria, especially this matrix that contains the many structures called as double-stranded DNA, circular double-stranded DNA. This is a circular double stranded DNA. So, outside of the nuclear DNA, the mitochondria also contains a DNA that is called as a circular double stranded DNA. Now, these mitochondria also contains ribosomes. Actually, we know very well ribosomes which are present in cytoplasm, especially on the surface of rough endoplasmic reticulum and also cytoplasm. But along with that, here it is an organelle, it is also present in the cytoplasm. But this organelle also contains the ribosomes. This is a very, very important point. These two points are very important points. They are interlinking the question, which means the nuclear material which is present in nucleus, but the DNA which is present in the cell of eukaryotes. The answer is both nucleus and also this mitochondria. So, this is must be remembered in this regard. Okay. Now, these matrix also contains divalent ions like ferrous, manganese, and magnesium, +2, +2, divalent ions, and also matrix that contains many enzymes or proteins. Here the DNA that is present in the mitochondria, which is very special structure, special feature that contains, it has a rich amount of GC content. GC content. The rich amount of GC content, what are the GC? Guanine and cytosine. Actually, we know very well adenine that pair with the thymine with the two bonds, guanine that pair with the three bonds, three hydrogen bonds with the cytosine. So here the DNA that contains high amount of the GC when compared with the AT. What is the function of GC? If the DNA that contains the high amount of GC, what is its role? Basically, due to the presence of GC content, it has a denaturation capacity is very less. If AT content is more, it needs denaturation energy is a very less. Whereas GC content is more, such DNA needs high energy for the breakdown of these three bonds. So this is the reason that present GC content in the mitochondrial DNA. So when compared with the nuclear DNA, the mitochondrial DNA that contains the rich amount of the GC content. Then what is the denaturation? Denaturation means, for example, this is the DNA, double stranded DNA. It contains these nucleotides in complementary manner. Here is A, here is T, here is G, here is C, with the triple bond and double bond, so on. The denaturation is these double stranded DNA that converted into the single stranded DNA. This one goes in this way, this one goes in this way. Finally, this converted into the two individual single stranded DNA. That is called as a denaturation. This denaturation takes more energy when these DNA strands, complementary strands that contains the high number of GC. Whereas this denaturation takes low energy, or cost of energy is very less, when these DNA strands that contains the high number of AT. So in this way, the DNA which present in the mitochondria that contains the high number of GC content. Okay, coming to the ribosomes. Ribosomes which are present in the mitochondria are the 70S ribosomes. 70S ribosomes. 70S ribosomes that present in the all eukaryotes. All eukaryotes. Eukaryotic mitochondria that consists 70S ribosome. This 70S ribosome again divided into two subunits, larger and smaller subunits. The large subunit is 50S, small subunit is 30S. But one more important point regarding to the mitochondrial ribosomes in mammals, not in all eukaryotes, especially in mammals, the mitochondrial ribosomes are the 55S. 55S. Similarly, it is also contains a large subunit 38S, small subunit 28S. Another important point here, the matrix that contains the high number of protons. High number of protons. This matrix high number of protons is present, which is essential for the electron transport system. These high number of protons get enter into the semi or peri mitochondrial space with the help of the pumps, proton pumps. With the help of the proton pump, the matrix that contain protons that enter into this space. Now, the inner mitochondrial membrane, the inner mitochondrial membrane only selectively permeable. Selectively permeable. Though the protons that enter into this one, this space contains proton does not easily enter into this way. Easily enter into the again matrix. It needs and it creates the A. Proton gradient in this space. These proton gradients, which is essential for the formation of ATP, that we will discuss in the next class. So here what we have to understand, the proton pump that transport inner side protons into the outer side. Inner side proton into the outer side. These proton coefficient or proton gradient, which is essential for the synthesis of the ATP in the inside of the matrix. I will discuss that one. Again, these inner membrane The inner membrane that contains the electron transport system. Electron transport system, which is formed with the proteins. That proteins which are present here. And this cristae that contains a specialized structure called as ATPase. All these proteins together we called as an electron transport system or electron transport chain. So these specialized ATPase we called as a F1, F0 ATPase. It is also called as oxysome. Actually, oxysome or F1, F0 ATPase that produces the ATP by using the proton gradient. Okay, this is all about the inner membrane. Whereas coming to the outer membrane is very permeable to all the components which are present in the cytoplasm into the perimitochondrial space. So, due to the presence of porins, the outer membrane is very permeable for all the substances into the perimitochondrial space. Whereas, the inner membrane that contains the proteins, the outer membrane that contains the porin is also protein. But instead, the contents of the outer membrane is rich in the lipids, whereas the inner membrane of mitochondria is very rich in the proteins. So, that is the difference. So, in this way, the mitochondria that contains all these components are very essential for the different functions. I will discuss in the next class. Especially here, one important concept to be remembered, these mitochondria actually not a eukaryotic organelle. Initially, this is not a eukaryotic organelle due to a theory called as a symbiotic theory. In evolutionary relationship, the symbiotic theory, which is revealed that these mitochondria came from the bacteria during the evolution condition, that bacteria in the symbiosis of the unicellular photosynthetic organisms and forms finally into mitochondria. That is, we will discuss, and it has a many similarities with the bacteria. That's why the symbiotic theory of evolution is mostly support to the organisms of eukaryotic cells or the cells of eukaryotes that came from the prokaryotes. This is showing the evolutionary relationship. Okay, let us start with the similarities between the mitochondria and the bacteria. See, the similarities between the bacteria and mitochondria. See, the first similarity is the mitochondria get into the self-renewal. Self-renewal, that means these mitochondria divide into two mitochondria, that is by the self-renewal, which is very similar to the binary fission of bacteria. We know very well one bacteria that present here that converted into like this through the binary fission and finally forms the two bacteria cells. Here also the mitochondria that is present here, they divide into two mitochondria like this and finally it gives the two mitochondria, individual mitochondria, through the process self-renewal, which is very similar to the binary fission of the bacteria. So this is a very important point. The second point is the ribosomes which are present in the mitochondria is the 70S. These 70S ribosomes also present in the bacteria. Bacteria also that present 70S ribosomes in cells. Coming to the one more important point, double circular DNA. Actually, in all eukaryotic cell, nuclear DNA is not a double circular. Okay, double circular is not a nuclear DNA, but the mitochondria that contains the double-stranded circular DNA, which is very similar to the bacterial DNA. Bacterial DNA also contains the double-stranded circular DNA. So, mitochondria also very similarly showing. Coming to the inner membrane of mitochondria, the inner membrane of mitochondria that contains the many proteins, nothing but transport system. The transport system and inner membrane of mitochondria, which is also very similar to the membrane of bacteria. Membrane of bacteria, which is also an evidence that is, this is came from the bacteria. And one more important point, antibiotics. Antibiotics like chloramphenicol, antibiotics, nothing but chloramphenicol, which actually act on the bacteria cells. Especially the chloramphenicol is the antibiotic that act on the bacterial photosynthesis, bacterial protein synthesis. It prevents the synthesis of proteins. So here the antibiotics of chloramphenicol that is also act on the protein synthesis of mitochondrial ribosomes. That act on the protein synthesis is done by the mitochondrial ribosomes. So it means the chloramphenicol is the antibiotic. Antibiotic is the name it indicates that act on the bacteria simply. But here if we take such antibiotics into our system, that antibiotics along with the bacterial protein synthesis inhibition that also inhibit the our own cells mitochondrial protein synthesis. So this is also one more evident. This is also one more evident that is very similar to the bacterial cell. So all these points which are showing that, and all these points which are helps in the symbiotic theory. Symbiotic theory. Then what is a symbiotic theory? Just you see, there is a unicellular organism which is formed in the universe. In the universe, this is a photosynthetically active. Photosynthetic unicellular organism are formed. These photosynthetically unicellular organism that engulf the bacteria. That engulf the bacteria. These bacteria that is present in the photosynthetically active unicellular eukaryotic cell, finally these bacteria that converted into the these mitochondria. That is the theory that showing the endosymbiotic theory. Endo means inside. Symbiosis means that together. Symbiotic means that together they form a structures, the bacteria that converted into mitochondria. This is all about the theory which showing the endosymbiotic theory of evolution. So the mitochondria that showing the very similar functions and similar structures that is present in the bacteria. And also one more important property of mitochondria is it is a semi-autonomous. Semi-autonomous. Semi-autonomous means actually it has the DNA and also it has the ribosomes. The DNA that convert into the mRNA, mRNA into the proteins. Is it right? But the proteins which are present in the mitochondria, all the proteins which are present in the mitochondria is not synthesized by the mitochondrial DNA. The synthesis of such many proteins are depend on the nuclear DNA. Nuclear DNA which produces some proteins that is exported to the mitochondria. So here, the though mitochondria that contains the DNA, that is mitochondria depend on the nuclear DNA for the many proteins. That's why it is called as a semi-autonomous organelle. There are many functions of mitochondria, how it produces the energy in the form of ATP, I will discuss in the next class. Thank you.